der Alex.
Oder? Ja, ich bin der
und
Alex.
Und du machst dann den Talk?
Ich mache den kompletten Talk, ja.
Okay, ich habe jetzt den Florian auch geschrieben. Auf
der das Geschichte. Machen wir ganz lustig, ja. Das sage ich dann den Leuten, warum das so ist. Oder auch ganz, ganz lustig. Ganz lustig.
Der schaut doch gut aus.
Oder? Siehst du irgendwas? Achso, ich muss mal schauen, wie der Teil ist.
Alex, muss ich
also
keine Sachen wegtun.
Davon ist was peinlich? Der Code. Der Code ist peinlich. Nein, also nicht. Und da starte ich dann.
Okay, hello everybody, welcome back to our monthly Computer Vision Meetup. Yeah. Yeah. We are also, as always, live on YouTube, so if you can make it here, you can also always watch the meetup on YouTube live, so that's nice. And we have an anniversary coming up, so next month there will be the 2-year anniversary for our Computer Vision Meetup. We have a lot of awesome stuff planned for the 2-year anniversary, so please, everyone should come by. It will be awesome, yeah. Promise. I can't say any details right now, but it will be awesome. Trust me. Yeah, and as always, the drinks are sponsored by Anyline, so please feel free to grab a beer or whatever else, water, what you like. I didn't find a better Giphy. I always have to use a new one, and I'm getting out of Giphy's. Yeah, so. Woo! Yeah. And we are also always looking for new speakers. So if anyone has a nice topic, what you can present, maybe some grill handle tracking or anything else, what you do is, I think everything can be interesting and it's nice for a talk. So please feel free to contact me. can be also 10 minutes lightning talks, whatever. We always have a hard time finding enough speakers for the meetup, so please contact me. Yeah, and that's it. So for today's agenda, there will be a grill handle tracking am Oktoberfest 2017 by not Florian, but Alex, but he will tell you why Alex and not Florian, I don't know. And afterwards, we have a consuming TensorFlow in .NET by Peter Spell from Anyline here, and he will tell you why he aged 20 years in the last 4 months trying to consume TensorFlow in .NET, yeah. So let's get started with the first talk and welcome Alex on stage. Okay.
Yeah, thanks for this opportunity. It's my first meetup here in Vienna about computer vision, and I know what it takes to run a meetup. I ran one on my own before I moved to Munich. I'm not Florian, so who knows Florian? No one either? Okay, you know. So we both founded a company, and I'm going to present tonight. And let me just log in. And it's about grill handle tracking. So grill handle is like barbecue chicken. And it might seem weird, but I will go into the technical details, the challenges, and also the human factors that made our project a success. So let me bring up the slides first. What you can see actually here on the left is like a cloud of dishes. And in particular, I'll talk about how we leverage transfer learning to come quickly to a solution that really rocked at the Oktoberfest. But first, I mean, why to track grill handle? I mean, actually why? Yeah? And in real time, so okay. So what you can see here is a view from the top of a bottleneck that exists in every tent, in every huge location where waiters take dishes from the kitchen to the guests. And what you can also see here are two persons. They just stand there and watch and make notes. And what they actually do is they check whether the small bones are the same, count the same dishes as the waiter carries out of through this bottleneck. Why do they do that? Because you have to combat the situation that too much food is carried out without declaring it on the bone, meaning that waiters make some extra on the side. And this problem is that big that you have to employ like these people who control. They are under high stress, so they must be rotated every 2 hours, or the error rate will go up. And of course, they must be highly trusted. And you have to do it let's just stick with the Oktoberfest, for 17 days straight. You rotate them every 2 hours, and still you don't have 100% certainty. So it's really a burdensome situation for everyone, right? So there's distrust, there is management overhead, all these sorts of things. And what's more, these people are not serving the guests, but have to wait. So actually, I mean, how did we discover that this is a problem? And goes back again back to Florian. We met, I think, 1.5 years ago at another meetup in Vienna. And after some time, he convinced me to take part in a hackathon at Audi in Ingolstadt. And we won this hackathon. And part of the prize was racing on ice slopes in Finland, in Lapland. And what we've done for Audi was real-time inventory management through image recognition. So we have thousands of containers, empty containers, and we presented that. It was quite cool. And we were asked by a person that we didn't know yet. He said, can you do the same with dishes? And we thought, in principle, yes. And then we discovered, okay, that's really, really a huge issue. And why not try it out together? And keep all the development's effort at such a pace that we can excel at the Oktoberfest. Right, so we tracked it in real time, and I want to show you a small video of how it worked out. So again, the same perspective. And now this is annotated video material, where you can see the dishes being marked up, and also, of course, the type. And of course, if you want to count the balance, what is being carried out, you need to track them from where you see them first to where you see them last. And you see these red arrows that denote what was carried out. So you can count it here on the bottom. And yeah, it was like 28 dishes. This is one of the most frequent one, like duck. This is not so frequent one, Spatzengaudi. Very tasty. You get free accommodation, free food when you do that for a restaurant. So that was good for me. And you see also that the pace. So we had a lot of challenges in terms of motion blur, in terms of occlusion, in terms of quickly learning to detect new dishes. And that's what I want to talk especially about today. How we solved it, that we quickly tracked unknown objects, meaning in like new menu. And you can also see like here if okay. Or not. Parts of the body were also tracked, like head and shoulders, for orientation and for occlusion. All right, cool. I could watch it forever. It's satisfying. why exactly is it satisfying? Because after the Oktoberfest, or during the Oktoberfest already, we benchmarked ourselves, like how many dishes did we track and how many did two independent human coders count over one day, one full day. And for our most frequent dishes, that was the ducks, we reached an agreement with 98.2%, which is actually in between the two human persons that went through the whole video the day independently. So it's a little bit beyond human recognition. That's our marketing slogan. But there's a little bit of truth in there. And in total, we had 20 types of dishes that we tracked, and like above 20, but 20 that went worked out quite well. We went into operation from just a sample video from the first 2 days, meaning 7 hours, 14 hours times two, into operation without seeing the dishes before within one day. So if you know a little bit about machine learning, and I really think you do, then the training is the real culprit that you need to solve, like the training data. And also it's like real time. We had a latency from 1 second from the network camera to the GPU, which was running all the time in the Oktoberfest tent, back to the marked up video stream, and with 20% GPU load. Three cameras actually, you only see one, and 20 frames per second. And I got very good word of mouth so far. So what I want to tell you about is what are the challenges to make this happen, and how did we use transfer learning for important subset of these challenges, namely how to get fast results from raw video. And then wrap up and outlook in terms of technology and transfer learning. So core challenges are how to get the right labels for unseen dishes from video, so from video to detection, how you make sure that the label quality is top-notch, how to develop a taxonomy of labels that that makes sense, meaning like a hierarchy. For example, to have a fallback, you recognize a sell ad, not always as the correct sell ad. So you have to make like a hierarchy of similar dishes so you can fall back and expose uncertainty to the user or to the curator of the system. And of course you have like often class imbalance, so we had like many grill handle but very few what was very seldom Spatzengarde was like actually in the middle, but yeah, these very big plates that you maybe saw, it's where a couple of ducks are on there, and we managed to learn this one dish so that it's usable in tracking with only 15 examples. The second set of challenges is how to make detection in still images work in real time with in a video feed. You have the blur, the occlusion, as I mentioned. These detectors that run in real time are noisy. Actually, all detectors are noisy. And compute time is in our budget. So we solved that throughout the summer. We took a lot of audio technology with us. This project is also running, so we could really like develop in parallel. And we used it, the tech stack from, okay, let me explain, from the acquisition part of the data to the science part to managing all the labels and all the views. We used like video encoding, decoding. We used OpenCV for data exploration. We used TensorFlow for the real-time part, PyTorch for experimentation. Does anyone know this kind of meme? Like PyTorch meme versus TensorFlow? Okay, it's very fun. It's one of the core maintainers, and PyTorch is that much more flexible, was the underdog, and now it's like everyone's jumping ship from TensorFlow and only wants PyTorch. So I leveraged this as well. And yeah, then we have the web framework. So the core solutions to the problems of before was we automated the most of the pipeline from raw video to high quality labels. We did that by extracting shots, still shots, only when objects have been manipulated. So you increase the variance of the same dish that you must label. So we have a variance of appearance of the same label class without making too much still shots. And for labeling like these matrix through human annotation, we halfway automated the recent proposals and the label proposals and made it collaborative effort. So basically we had, in this one day, we had three labelers that were sitting in Vienna and me in Munich, and they worked in real time in collaboration. So one guy said, this is this dish, and the other one already got the recommendation, like instantly. And you got to have a training strategy for labels that are either incomplete or might not be correct, despite all the quality assurance. Right, and the other part I'm going to skip, so I'm going to talk about especially transfer learning for label proposals to help the annotation process. We calculate, like, if you would go through each video, pause it, make a still shot manually, select the object, maybe get some help, like, tracking of this. But in fact, we calculate that we are factor 30 faster for making this training material. Before we had any dish data or specific dish data, I made an experiment which models are feasible to begin with to recommend labels. And so I plotted here the whole Model Zoo of PyTorch, the, all the models that are in there, versus how long they take to train, because training is a budget. Training must be robust. You cannot pamper with the model if you think, if you are under stress. It just has to train well, and without, you don't have a second chance, or don't want to take a second chance. And the second metric was, of course, accuracy, and then like those three architectures were good to examine further. Okay, so that's not all. So we had three candidates, AlexNet, ResNet 34, and SqueezeNet. And I really wanted to take SqueezeNet because it's that elegant and small and new. But AlexNet made a comeback, I can already spoil. And it's not because of my name. What we really did to assess the perfect model to recommend the labels in the labeling annotation process was we took for each model different layers, different depth, reduced them to between 1,000 and 4,000 dimensions with average pooling and varying kernel size. And then we ranked, if you see this dish or this plate or object once, how many nearest neighbors are actually really the nearest neighbors in terms of the same class. I don't know, am I talking too fast or? Okay, cool. Because I already talked about it once, and when I do it a second time, it's always scary. No, it's always, I might go too fast. All right, so this is the first assessment, which model gives the most accurate nearest neighbors, but also, and this is very important, it turned out, which model gives the most plausible false positives. Meaning that here you see AlexNet describing the desserts, yeah, to be also similar to each other, that's good, and also an empty plate to be the next similar thing, which is also good. The most surprising or most insightful finding was that it also recommended, irrespective of the color, more irrespective of the color, meaning that was labeled empty, and it took the empty dish, although it only has seen like a black tablet and not the dish, empty plate, and it also turned out that the highest degree of separation in this vector space was achieved also by AlexNet. So this is one kind of book, and the blackness indicates how far the next similar class is, and the difference with AlexNet was the highest. So SqueezeNet didn't get the third nearest neighbor right most of the time. It didn't get this as sharply separated as the others. And this was the decision process. And so we used this as a label recommendation, and I should clarify it one more time. So we had this multi-tenant collaboration tool of snapshots and where people said which dish is it. And each time one label was labeled, is what it was inserted in the database, the fingerprint of the image was inserted in the database to be recommended already in the next frame. So the effect was that, one annotator just labeled the dish once. We did no retraining at all, like zero, like just the embeddings. And the next time it was already, oh, is this a bio handle? Is this a salad? And that was very rewarding. So people were faster and had the idea that they're really working together with the system, that it's not an effort that they that's wasted or it gets boring, was surprisingly good. And because more people were working at it at the same time, they benefited from the material that was labeled by the others, like real time.
Right.
So now we have a lot of good data, which is good. So after the Oktoberfest, now we have this much data, I rerun all the assessment, what can be a better tool for us or a better architecture in the future. And I did that a second time. And now I should go more into detail. So the sharp corners are, if you train a pre-trained model on ImageNet for the whole, for all the layers, the round ones, if you only train the layers beyond the layers you decided to separate, and the square one is totally like randomly initialized. And with this more data, the benchmark changed. So AlexNet is still very high quality in these terms, but much better if we deeply retrain it. So, I mean, that's a simple conclusion. If you have more data, you can train deeper, right? But will it actually work? You only know after you really tried it out. Then I also wanted to equalize the training strategy a little bit with cyclical learning rates, because not all the training strategies have been tuned, like hyperparameter space for all the models. So I tried to do that. And it's also very interesting that if you that some architectures are very sensitive and really don't work at all with cyclical learning rates. And your DenseNet and ResNet do benefit quite substantially. I have not like found any hypothesis yet for it, but it warrants, at least it warrants a second look to which model we choose on this like curve of training time versus accuracy. Right, okay. I'm actually rushing through here. One more thing, so when we created all the pipeline, you encounter strange bugs, and neural nets are hard to debug. There is this famous tweet of Andrei Kapathy, that you don't really know if it's not working because of the data, because of something else, because they will try to fit anything, the loss will go down. And if you look here on this first row, you can see that we trained one dessert with the bug, and the loss is almost equal, monotonically decreasing, wouldn't raise any suspicion. And if you do it the first time, like a mean average precision of dishes, object detection, you don't know if that is like okay. Is it because here it started overfitting or something like that? So yeah, you don't know. But there was actually a bug where you wouldn't expect it to be. Otherwise it wouldn't be a bug. And so the loss didn't decrease. And I think if you have such a overfitting, a smooth overfitting curve, where you can see a peak that is smooth, and you can overfit it, because here you weren't sure, is it's too rapid. So if a smooth overfitting curve, this is somehow for me the unit test of machine learning. After that, you can still decrease your model capacity and all this stuff. Okay, so transfer learning helped us to achieve the goal, because otherwise you would always have a huge trade-off between labeling costs, compute costs, and accuracy. So if you want to get rid of architecture exploration, you can look into learning to learn, like Google does it, but it costs $2 million to compute, like almost random exploration of architectures. And with transfer learning, you have like a very good win-win situation for everyone. So academia benefits because you make your architecture widespread. It goes into the direction that you make it modular, different neural networks, reusable, composable, and what's more, you don't have to share your raw data, so it also helps transfer between industry and academia, and other models like federated machine learning, where you train your local models but don't share your true data. It opens up whole new possibilities. So I'm a huge advocate of doing that further. And actually, my meetup that I founded in Vienna was Ethereum, this blockchain stuff, if someone knows. And it's a lot about data privacy here in Ethereum and blockchain world. And there is this one very cool project that tries to learn from private data, and it's called OpenMind. And I encourage everyone who wants to be on the frontier of these things to join the project. It's growing huge and tries to achieve the impossible, which is cool. Yeah. So like homomorphic encryption and all these things, very vibrant. Okay, so the takeaway foods, yeah, get it? Like, okay, no. What we are doing is a customization of object detection with as little cost as possible. Therefore, the ultimate goal for us is one-shot learning. So with one dish, we can track it through any video streams in real time. We want that machines ask us the question in the labeling process. Well, the uncertainty, it must be much more rigid. That's our goal. That's our challenge also data science-wise. It's a good goal to have. I think it's much better to have such a goal than as a data scientist to get some structured data from SAP and be told, tell me something about it. Right, it's just boring without any, if you don't have the real business value in knowledge what you're actually doing. So I think this is a very good goal, a good challenge. It also kind of taught me that although it's 20% work in all this tech stack until you get the clean data, until you get the clean data, the payback of model fidelity is highly nonlinear. So if we would just recommend labels that are 65% of the times correct, it wouldn't be that motivating or surprising or successful for that matter. So if you have to cross the boundary where it's surprising, or also if we had an accuracy or agreement of the counted dishes of like 80%, no one would care, right? It's just okay, fair, good exercise, but it's not usable. So yeah, I think this is why I'm so passionate about to like for each percent, it's really worthwhile. And yeah, and final takeaway as for us, make data science very collaborative and also decrease the cost for any iteration of your pipeline. So for example, what we've developed is a replay, almost like a data store, mart for video data. It's just a SQL query. So you query and you can have any scene of any day of the Oktoberfest and the other restaurants that we already have, and replay it with a click of a mouse with different models. So it's a lot of work to do that, but then it makes fun. So that's good. And yeah, last point, we are hiring. So please, talk to me and Florian afterwards, or now if you have any questions. Any questions?
You made
The cyclical learning rate. It's quite new, and it seems so unfounded in any theory that it's just, I think it's an accident. It's just an accidental technique that worked well for the author and works for some models. I don't have any like good explanation of when you should do it. Actually, you should more look into stochastic gradient descent with restarts. That's evolved from the cyclical learning rate. But what it's very simple. You just ramp up and ramp down the learning rate. About for each 1,000 epochs, 40 or 50 times, it seemed to me it works better for models that work better in principle with that. And if you see here, you can replicate it with your own models because I have it on GitHub. Right, local minima. You hop over the local minima, give it a pump. We could also say it's a form of regularization because, or inject some randomness almost. Yeah. So, in this way, it's explainable. Yeah, I think so. Any other questions? No. Okay. Yeah. Then, thank you.
So I think we make a 5 to 10 minute short break for the restroom and to fill up with new drinks, and then we continue with Peter's TensorFlow talk. Thanks. Was geschieht? Habe ich eine Mail-Einladung gekriegt? du das drin? Hast du das nicht irgendwo im Development Folder oder in deiner? Schick mir einen Schein. Slack? Muss ich Slack kann auch machen. Ja, beim Mic losbleiben. Ja. Passt.
Wenn ich Hi. Gut. Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Peter. I'm a developer for Anyline, and I work mainly with C# and .NET. And over the past over the summer, my task was to basically port and integrate TensorFlow in our Windows UWP SDK, and it was really cumbersome. And now I'm going to share some struggles or steps that I had to do in order to fulfill this task. So, yeah, basically I'm going through a brief introduction. I'm quickly gonna describe the architecture and some terms and definitions of the TensorFlow library. And then I will be talking about how to actually build TensorFlow with the Windows build system and what steps you have to take, what modifications if you want to build it for 32-bit and not 64-bit. I will get to that. And then briefly how you can consume it in your C++ runtime library. So yeah, I know everybody probably knows what TensorFlow is, so I'm not going to talk about what it is. But yeah, it's basically a library for neural networks. The thing is, TensorFlow is open source, and it has a very large community with over 1,000 contributors. And when you look at that graph here, those are the weekly commits over the past months, and it's always around 200 and or 300 commits per week. And since TensorFlow version 0.12, there has been an experimental Windows support. And now we have the version 1.3.1, and TensorFlow 1.4 is already in the first release client, so that's quite some version upgrades. And yeah, TensorFlow, as you probably know, it's most people use it in Python. You can also reference it in C++, Java, and Go. And what we're going to do is to use the TensorFlow C++ API. So this is basically the architecture of the TensorFlow library. It is split into training and inference. And the C library, the C API, is basically the common API that relies under the Python client, the C++ client, and so on. And what's for us important is the inference with C++. So when I say consuming TensorFlow in .NET, I mean actually building the inference libraries compiled in C++, creating a Windows runtime component, and wrapping those standard C++ classes with C++ CX wrappers, so that they can then be consumed in C# or any other .NET language. So there are a few terms or definitions that I would quickly like to go through that are important or were important to know when working with the source code. So first of all, a session. A session in TensorFlow is something that encapsulates or kind of creates an environment where I can execute operations and where I can evaluate tensors. And with sessions, you also you load graphs. So yeah, a graph is a set of operation objects and tensor objects. Actually, I'm not gonna read this all. The thing is, TensorFlow has kernels and operations, and they're in the source code. They have a kind of a operation register and a kernel register. And one of the most tricky parts for modifying and linking the TensorFlow library was that those kernels and operations, they were kind of, the global constructors were put in a template where the linker would strip out the objects that were created, because the linker, the Microsoft linker, thought that they would not be needed. I will show you quickly how this looks. So, okay, we want to build TensorFlow for 32-bit and not 64-bit. Why the 32-bit? For us, it was important because we have depending libraries like OpenCV and other libraries built in 32 bits, and you can't just link different architectures together. You have to have them all in the same architecture. And for example, for the HoloLens operating system currently only works in 32-bit. And also, if you have a 32-bit application or process, you can run it in a 64-bit environment, but not vice versa. I'd like to note that this is only meaningful for consuming the library and doing inference, like a forward pass, but not for training actually networks, because this would be a huge waste of resources. Yeah. Okay. So the build system in TensorFlow, you know Bazel, but for Windows, Bazel is not officially supported. I think there are experimental builds, but the way to go here is to use the CMake script. So they have, if you clone the repository, you will have a contrib, a subfolder, and then you will have CMake scripts to build all the Visual Studio projects. And these Visual Studio projects, then with them you can build all the necessary libraries. This will produce like over 100 or 200 small libraries that are basically the whole TensorFlow package. And yeah, this is only for 64-bit per default. And when you want to adapt this was the hardest part, to adapt this for 68. You have to basically adapt the CMake files and also parts of the code. So what do you need for this? First of all, you need a quite fast PC. And it is, I highly recommend having more than 8 GB RAM, because I ran out of heap space on my notebook when compiling it, because the object files that are generated are huge. And also it can take really long time. It can take up to 3 hours, depending on what you are building. So yeah, recommended a fast PC. You need Windows 10 and I used Visual Studio 2015. Also, you need Git, you need Swig, you need CMake, of course, and Python. And if you want to support GPU, you need CUDA and cuDNN, but I have not used this. So yeah, first of all, you have to prepare the Visual Studio compiler with a small, it's called vcvarsall.bat, that's kind of just loads where the compilers are, depending on which architecture you want to compile it for. And yeah, we are using TensorFlow 1.2, so we are checking out the release 1.2. And when loaded, you have this subfolder, it's called contrib slash cmake. This is where all the Windows build cmake files are. Now, in these scripts, there are per default parameters, the x64 parameter. You have to just throw it out when you want to build it for 68. And this is basically the command that you have to run CMake with to create all those Visual Studio projects. So you have to say the build type has to be released because debug is not supported. Only the release is supported. You have to point to the right SWG and Python libraries and executables. And you have to set the build shared lib flag to on. This will build the shared lib, but also the static lib projects. But if you switch it to off, it's kind of buggy and it doesn't produce either. So yeah. And it was a lot of trial and error and researching how other people managed to do it. So this is basically the working configuration. And yeah, once you have executed this command, you will have the Visual Studio solution and projects in the folder that you ran it. So yeah, now you have the huge solution that has hundreds of projects. The important projects will be the protobuf project, the eigenproject, and the example tutorials trainer project. Yeah. So what you have to do to make it work is the protobuf project will itself start some scripts and it will itself create another solution for the protocol buffer library, which you have to generate at first. And you have to manually adapt this library to switch from the 64-bit to the 32-bit and compile it. Because relying on this library are some other TensorFlow libraries, and they would not compile with a linker. They would have a linker error. So you have to adapt this. You can verify any library that you create with this Microsoft tool dump bin, and when you execute this tool with the headers flag on a specific library, then you will see for the definitions if it is 64-bit or not. So that's how you know if you have a really 64-bit or not compiled library. The next thing that you also have to do is to adapt the eigen library. For eigen, you have to. The thing is, on other platforms than Windows, this you have a narrowing conversion warning. When you have in the source code, there are so-called initializer lists, and if there are data types in these initializer lists that have a different type but can be cast, the compiler will just say, okay, here's a warning, this will automatically be a narrowed conversion. But the Microsoft compiler is a bit more strict and it will fail. So this kind of gets rid of the problem here. Yeah, it was hard to track this and find out how to solve it. That's why I'm presenting it here. yeah, finally, in TensorFlow, you have to make a few code adaptations as well. For example, in the file BFC allocator, you have to use this macro instead of this macro. Yeah. Okay, so that's the few modifications that are really necessary for the projects that we want to run. And once you have done that, you can now call the ms build command with the release configuration. And we want to run the TensorFlow Tutorials example trainer project, because this example trainer project all the libraries we need, the example trainer project depends on them, and it will create all those libraries in the correct order. And yeah, when finally built, this takes a lot of time, but when everything works out, then you have this executable file, and in this executable file you have various checks that verify if everything actually works as planned or not. And you just execute this in the command line, and then you will have this kind of output. So when you see this is a good thing. Yeah. Okay, that's the step to build TensorFlow actually. Now we want to use it. That was also a very hard part. That actually took me more time. Yeah. First of all, you have to use a few of the same preprocessor directives as the example shows. You have to use the compiler MSVC and the no-min-max flag, the no-min-max especially because when you have a runtime component in Windows, it will redefine the min and max, and this will, you know, tell it to not worry about that. And yeah, for all the libraries that you need, those are the basic four libraries. You will just find them in the corresponding release folders where you have built it. And either you just copy them or you reference the additional include directories to where all those libraries reside. And these are the include directories where the source code lies. So the approach here is to link TensorFlow statically into the runtime component. And when you just link the libraries, then it won't work at runtime. It will succeed to link it, but once you run it, then TensorFlow will crash with an exception that the operations are not registered, the session cannot be loaded, the kernels are not found, etc. And this is because TensorFlow has a specific pattern for registering these things. A guy in GitHub posted this pseudocode showing why this happened. So you have these register templates, and in the corresponding operation classes, you have you're using this template, and this leads to the fact that the linker will not know that these objects have to be linked in, and they will simply be stripped out. And the linker will not complain because he says, okay, everything's fine, but at runtime, TensorFlow will not have registered those operations and kernels. So the solution here, I believe this is also for other platforms. They have a similar solution like all the all load flag in iOS. the option in Windows is called whole archive. And this basically forces the linker to include every object file. But you can't just simply say whole archive for everything because the Microsoft compiler will crash and you have to find out which archives you have to specifically link with this flag. So for our example, we need the tfcore direct session lib. That's for the loading the sessions. Yeah, we're using the core CPU because we have not built it with GPU, we're just using the CPU. And we need the core operations and the core kernels. So yeah. Okay. And now we have linked in the TensorFlow libraries that we need in our runtime component, in our C++ runtime component, and we want to expose them to C# and .NET. So we basically create a wrapper class, which has this signature, public ref class, whatever, and sealed. This is kind of the rule for runtime components in order to expose them to the other .NET languages. So there are, as I said, a few rules. They have to be in a root names in the root namespace of the runtime component. And everything that you want to expose has to have the public modifier. And everything that is with the public modifier, so the public interfaces, public classes, public structs, they will be put in the Windows metadata file, the WinMD file, and then can be referenced and consumed in any other .NET language. And the standard C++ objects and functionality that you want to use, you have to hide it behind like in internal or private modifiers. And you can only expose C++ CX types and not standard C++ types. Also something like integers, but yeah. So yeah, this is kind of a quick and dirty code sample how this might look. You have this public public ref class with a public create session and public constructor, and we'll just say, okay, in this create session, we will just start a new TensorFlow session with a graph. We have not initialized or loaded this because this is just an example. And we return the TensorFlow status if it worked or not. And this is all that you will see. And we keep the real TensorFlow session object private. And in the destructor, we will delete it again. And then you can consume this in C sharp, for example, with TensorFlow is with calling just the new constructor and calling the public method. And yeah, this is basically how you wrap it and consume it. Yeah, thank you. Any questions? No, took me a long time. Yeah. I think I'm the first to do it with 32-bit. I haven't seen any other cases. I mean, I really searched through all of GitHub and TensorFlow and Microsoft forums for this. Some people have managed to build it in in 64-bit, because that's what they needed. But this is, yeah. Yeah, I mean the thing here is these are kind of manual patches and code changes, and they have to. Sorry. They would have to have it automated so it works with one click and not, you know, twitching around and stuff. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Yes.
How far is TensorFlow serving with it, or is it just saying?
Sorry?
TensorFlow server component of TensorFlow.
I have not worked with the server component yet, no. I've just concentrated on what we needed from TensorFlow, and yeah. Yeah, basically, our Anyline SDK for Windows is it's for tablets like the Microsoft Surface or HoloLens. Yeah, that's actually how it started. We started actually with Windows Phone 8.1, but the phone market died, and then I focused on upgrading the code base and everything to HoloLens and make a HoloLens prototype. And yeah.
Will it be easier in the future to transfer training models to CNTK with the O and X standard?
I don't know.
Hopefully. I think that's a new standard, right? For saving, for basically for run inference.
Yeah. We've already thought of, you know, taking our networks and extracting the weights and putting that into the Microsoft neural network library, but turns out then Microsoft library is even less supportive in what we need than TensorFlow. So it was easier for us to go this way. So, yeah. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. Then thank you.
Part. You can still stay here and drink another drink and mingle around and networking stuff. And except from that, I hope to see you all next month, our anniversary. It will be fun. We have huge stuff planned. A lot of stuff planned, yeah. Can't talk about it right now, but trust me. So thanks for coming and see you next month. Thank you. Bye.